Okay. I want to start this presentation with a very simple question. I would like to ask you, what have you done this morning since you woke up until you end up here? So what have you done, Xavier?
Well, for example, in my case, I have woke up very early. I have turned on the lights. I have prepared a coffee. I have took the subway. And finally, I have listened carefully the long speech of the directors.
Okay, that's very good. Do you notice that all these actions share something in common?
No. What?
Energy, Xavier. In order to execute each one of these actions, we need energy. Because we live in a world which is energy dependent. And our society relies deeply on energy to maintain the life standards.
Yes, I agree with you. But you have forgotten to mention the pay that we have to pay for this price. So, in other words, to produce this energy, we need to burn fossil fuels that produces pollution. This pollution is killing people, and it's not a problem of the faraway countries. It is now happening here. And the pollution is not the end of this story. There is a big elephant in the room. The production of CO2 due to the combustion of fossil fuels is increasing the temperatures in the world. And you know the consequences. The consequences you can watch in the TV more often, and it is the so-called climate change. And well, now the climate change has been declared one of the catastrophic global risks. So, Danny, the situation is unsustainable.
Yes. And that's right, Xavier, but keep calm, because in our group we are working on a solution. It's called fusion energy. And let me ask you something. How the perfect energy would look like?
Well, let me think. I think it should be unlimited, clean, and robust.
Yes, that's it. So let me show you. So in fusion we use water as the main fuel, so it's going to be kind of virtually unlimited. Moreover, it's clean because it does not produce radioactive waste and it's carbon-free and it's robust since it's available 24/7 and it's very energetically dense because with a small quantity of fuel, you're going to produce a large amount of energy. For those reasons, we believe that fusion is the perfect source of energy. And let me show you how we can do it here on Earth. So we've got this fantastic recipe, which is inspired on stars. So the only thing we need to do is to take some hydrogen gas, isotopes of hydrogen gas. We need to confine it in a container, heat it up to 100 million degrees, keep supplying some fuel, and voila, you have the fusion reactions.
Wait. Do you want to solve the climate change by making a star on the surface of the Earth? Are you crazy, man? Do you want to destroy the planet?
Okay, no. This is not going to happen, Xavier. Don't worry. So here you can see some of the reactors. There are quite a few here. They are spread worldwide. And mainly these reactors use these magnetic fields which confine just a small quantity of plasma. And there are two main branches. The one that we are working here at the BSC in the fusion group is the so-called tokamak design.
So, Danny, are you working with all these tokamaks?
Not with all of these. We are working with the ones that are shown here. We work through Eurofusion. Eurofusion is the European consortium for the fusion research.
So I see that you are doing a lot of research, but I haven't seen any fusion power plant operating yet.
Yeah, and you are right. So let me give you a global view of fusion. So in 1933, we had the first demonstration of fusion. We had the first reaction in a lab. Then in 1958, roughly 25 years later, we have the first design of a tokamak in Russia. Then in 2026, which is more or less roughly 10 years from now, we will have the first plasma in ITER. ITER is the reactor which is going to show that a positive energy balance is possible in fusion. And then in the 50s, we will build the demonstration power plant, which, well, mainly it's going to be connected to the electric grid, so it's going to produce fusion electricity.
50s?
Yep.
Wow, fusion scientists are always telling the same. Fusion is really, in 20 years we will have fusion here. Why do I have to trust you?
Okay, I think that you are a computer scientist, Xavier, so I'm pretty sure you are going to know what this plot is, don't you?
Yes, of course. It's the famous Moore's Law.
Yeah.
It shows basically the evolution of the computer hardware. It's really impressive because every 2 years, the number of transistors doubled.
Yep, that's that's exactly it, Xavier. So we've got an equivalent in fusion, but instead we use the triple product. The triple product is mainly a measure of the success of magnetic confinement. And look how close we are of a commercial reactor. We are just one step to reach a commercial reactor. In the meanwhile, we are waiting for this ITER reactor to operate.
Yeah, it's near equivalent, yeah.
Yeah, it's very equivalent. And just let me show one more example. Maybe I can convince you. So do you know something about history of cars?
No.
Not really, right?
No.
Okay, who knows? So let's go. In 1867, the first internal combustion motor was designed. It was already invented, but I think it was 32 years after, people were still using horses as a medium of transport, but they knew that cars were far better. In 10 years, after that moment, surprisingly, New York, the streets of New York were full of cars. And what happened? What happened?
I don't know.
What happened is that 5 years before, Ford implemented for the first time the assembly line, which made cars commercial. And this is, in an analogy, it's most probable what is going to happen with fusion. So now we have the reactors, we have demonstrated fusion, but we are waiting ITER to make it commercial.
Okay, Dani, you convinced me.
So now that you are convinced, Xavier, let's...
yeah.
Let's dream a bit. Let's put our imagination on the stars. And who knows, maybe one day... we start having some fusion-propelled spacecraft that bring us to the stars. Hope so, right?
Yeah, well, we want to finish with message from Fusebel, so get ready, because fusion is coming.
Thank you.